Hello, today is the beginning of a short series on winterizing our woodwind instruments. Here in the Northern Hemisphere in New York, it is November. It's actually November everywhere as I make this video. And what that means for me and for those of us who live up here is the colder, drier air is going to be part of our lives for the next several months. This presents unique problems for us as woodwind players, and I'd like to talk about how we manage those problems as they relate to our reeds, our instruments, and the maintenance of all of that. Today, we're going to specifically talk about the first issue, how we get water in our keys. Now look, it doesn't need to be winter for this problem to happen. In the summertime, we're blowing through our instruments, and our instruments are colder than our bodies. And what happens is that the moisture from our breath, which is a gas, condenses inside the colder instrument and it creates that liquid. That's why we swab our instruments out. But in the wintertime, our instruments are typically in a colder environment. And what that means is that condensation happens quicker and it happens more often. As we open up a pad, there's water in that key and we've got to get that water out quickly. So what I've done is I've assembled a bunch of things that are either sold specifically for the purpose of removing water from your key, and some things that I found that are not sold specifically for that purpose, just to see how we can most efficiently and effectively and cost effectively get that water out of our keys so we can get back on with our practicing or our performing. Here we go. The first thing I want to talk about is how to remove water from pads. Something that I see people do, which is probably the worst possible thing, is they will take the pad drying cloth, they would put it in here, and then they would pull it out of the key. You never, ever, ever want to do that. Simply put, you put it in, you maybe touch it if you need to, you lift up the key and you remove it. You don't want to drag anything between your key and the instrument because that will very, very quickly screw up the seal of your instrument. So that is the method. As our test bed, this is very scientific, I've got this black piece of wood, which is going to stand in for my bass clarinet, and I've got a dropper and I've got some water. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually put a drop of water on here and we're going to test all these to see how quickly and effectively they soak the water up. Now, what we're going to do is I'm going to use this BG drying pad, which I've had for a long time. I've used it, I've loved it, and I've got a little drop of water right here. I'm going to place it on there like we would on our key and see how quickly it will remove the water and how, when I remove this, how much of the water still remains. This is dry. I'm going to place it right on here and I'm just going to press. And that does a pretty good job. You can see that there's liquid on here and most of the liquid is gone there. Now I'm going to try a version of it where I don't press on it. And just kind of sit it there. So without pressing, it doesn't remove the water as well. So that's something to think about. In other words, pressing would be the equivalent of pressing the key down. So you've got to press the key down for it to do the soaking. Next up are the Yamaha cleaning papers. And I'm going to just open up this pack and I'm going to remove one of them, one of the sheets here. Now this is a tissue kind of material, but it's firm, right? It's not like it's not like Kleenex. It holds up. It can't be so flimsy that it won't slide under your key very easily, but this does, right? You put it in, you drop your key, you lift up your key. So what I'm going to do is the same thing. I'm going to take a drop of water. I remove it. There's still some liquid right there, so I will flip the page over, do it again, and there's still some water on there. And I'm sure I can get it all off. But I'm noticing that it's depositing new water over here. This illustrates a couple things that I don't like about it. Number one, it doesn't get all of the water off the first time out. But the thing that I really don't like about it is that once this paper is wet, it is very, very flimsy, right? So it could easily rip itself off and deposit some of this paper on your on the bottom side of your pad, which just simply means that you need to go in there and get it out. But it also means that it's single use. Now, you can dry this paper, and believe me, I have. You can dry this paper and reuse it, but really, this is a disposable, one-use type of thing. So that is the Yamaha cleaning paper. That is incidentally why they give you so many sheets of it in this pack, because it really is a one-use sort of thing. Next up are cigarette papers. By the way, none of us smoke, right? We're clarinet players. We can't smoke. Now, you can get these gummed or ungummed. Right here it says gummed. You obviously do not want to get the gummed type because all this gum is going to do once it gets wet is deposit some sticky crap on your pads. Sticky crap on pads, obviously you don't want. Again, this is stiff, just like the Yamaha cleaning papers, but let's see if it has the same issues that the Yamaha cleaning papers have. And just like the Yamaha cleaning pads, it soaks this up really, really, really quickly. I mean, you can see it's completely waterlogging this sheet. It leaves a fair bit of it here, and again, just like the Yamaha paper, exactly like the Yamaha paper, this begins to disintegrate once it's wet. So for the same reason that I don't especially care for Yamaha cleaning papers, I don't care for cigarette papers either. Chamois. Chamois is typically used, and you buy it, in a large cloth like this. And what I've done is I just cut off a piece of the cloth to use here to try for this test. You use it basically to dry your car. So if it can dry my car, maybe it can dry my bass clarinet pad. And I'm going to place this down. Okay, you can't really see anything soaking up. I'm going to lift it up. It doesn't appear to have done anything. Let me flip this over. Maybe it's the other side that does the soaking. No, not at all. All right, let me try pressing on it. And all it seems to be doing is squeezing the water out the side. All right, so I would call this a fail. Next up is a synthetic chamois. You can also buy this in auto parts stores, and it also comes in a large cloth. I have cut this piece off, so let's give this one a try. Same issue. Let me dab it. Seems to be a bit of a fail as well. Okay, I've got this other kind of synthetic chamois that I bought. Is a little bit thicker, and it seems to be a little bit coarser. Yes! Synthetic chamois for the win! I mean, this cloth to me, frankly, feels a little bit like something that you would use on as a swab, but it is so thick that it probably will not work for more delicate instruments like flutes and clarinets and oboes. It might work for bassoons and bass clarinets and saxophones. So this synthetic chamois seems to be, we're going to put this aside as a potential win. So next up I have two pieces of microfiber. Microfiber is sold by what they call weight per square meter. So this is very thin at 100 grams per square meter. Basically, it's extremely light, but it also has the stiffness of these cleaning papers. This one is a little bit softer and a little bit thicker. This is 130 grams per square meter. So let's try the thicker one first. Wow. So this is the 130 grams per square meter. And then this is the super thin kind. Great, so I think we have three winners here. And the BG pad dryer, I like it. It's thin, obviously I've used it for a while, but it's sturdy. I mean, I've owned this for a few years. Cigarette paper and Yamaha cleaning paper, I'm gonna call a big fat no. Number one, because it's, you know, it creates more waste than I like. And second of all, the papers themselves are really flimsy. You use them once and then they fall apart. Now, looking at the chamois that I have here, this thick chamois, total fail. Same goes for this piece of faux chamois. Chamois itself, it did not soak it up very well. This piece of chamois was a success. It is thick though, and so it is not great for every instrument. I think it might be good for larger instruments. So then we have our two microfiber cloths. This microfiber cloth, this is the 130 gram per square meter. I liked it a lot. It worked really, really well. But then as I started messing with it, it started to fray. And this fraying material will eventually, it's coming off in my hands, which means that it will come off in your instruments. Finally, I have the 100 gram per square meter microfiber. This one does not fray, and it was super absorbent. It's strong, and it dries fairly quickly. I've tried it, so I keep a couple of these in my case as well. And so there you have it, the winner. The microfiber cloth, 100 gram per square meter. I like this. I actually use this in, I've cut a bunch of these pieces and they're in my case. They dry really quickly. They work very well. So that's been the first of, I think probably going to be a three-part series on winterizing your woodwind instrument. And we will see you next week when we're going to talk about how to handle reeds in the winter when it gets super, super dry like it is right now. Okay? See you then.